Welcome back, everyone. Let's give it up for Aleksandr, the chief architect at Luxoft, who's going to talk to us about modernizing the DevOps world. Take it away.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we are not going to talk about modernizing the DevOps world. We are going to talk about modernizing the world and how to overcome challenges in implementing DevOps for the legacy modernization projects. So I am a chief architect in legacy modernization services of Luxoft here in Belgrade. And so what we are doing is we are helping huge companies with huge products, which are legacy products, to modernize their way of working and to modernize their business. And today we are going to talk about how to implement DevOps in those kind of projects. So this talk is going to be a little bit on a high level. I will show you why. And down below on the slide, here are some figures that just to give you an impression of how much legacy we currently have and how much modernization projects we are going to have in the upcoming years. So essentially, if you book tickets here to fly here, your requests came to the mainframe like 5 to 6 times. All right, and specifically about legacy. The applications that we are dealing with, they are have like common ground and some similarities. So it's always a huge applications which are very important for the business. And they have like a history of 40 to 30 years of constant engineering. And when we start working on them, it's always that kind of issues that they have. So like code road, bad UI UX, and bad integration capabilities. And the common ground for all of this is that the business needs to make those applications more agile and to make it fast, okay? It's always the case. And we're also going to talk about DevOps, so please raise your hand who is working within the DevOps team here. All right. Good amount of people. Thank you very much. And have you seen that picture? No? This is not a DevOps. So if you could trace that to any situation within your project or within your company or within your team, you are not doing a DevOps, because DevOps is more about the way of working. DevOps is about sailing the same boat to the same direction and having the same goals. And if you are not doing that, probably you are not doing DevOps, or at least you are in the middle of a DevOps transformation. So again, I am going to talk about DevOps as a way of working with embrace on people. And the tools fade away here. Tools, they need to help to facilitate that way of working, but not the other way around. So when we started to implement DevOps in our projects, it's a huge transformation of a big system. We started to see all of those fancy things like better deployment times, better delivery times, cheaper transformations, cheaper work, better quality, less bugs, and all that stuff. So you can find a lot of like benefits of DevOps in the internet. This is just a Maruti Tech Lab's take on that. I really like that list, but it's not the only one. So when you start to do a DevOps, you will start to see a lot of benefits. And for the modernization projects, which are again very, very complicated technically, and we are very prone to the timelines, these things are very important. I will not, I will lie if I say that you just go install Kubernetes or you just go change the culture of your company and you will have a DevOps and it's going to be fine. It will not going to be fine. We had the experience of like 5+ years of implementing DevOps for the different teams, different customers, and there is always a challenge. There is a lot of them. I'm going to talk about first four of them today. And you don't see any like infrastructure changes or your pipeline changes or anything like that in that list, because those are not challenges. Those are tasks, engineering tasks. We have bright minds, sharp whatever, and we could do that. But when it's time to mess with the people, it's always a hard time. So let's start from the first one. Changing the culture is hard. So look at the picture. Do you think those guys are doing DevOps or not? They are running pretty fast in the same direction. Just raise your hand who thinks they do DevOps. Okay, good, they don't. Why? Because they are not sharing the goal of that team. It's somewhere in that place, but nobody helping each other, and everybody performing as much as he can, running as fast as he can within his own KPIs, within his own restrictions. And this is not DevOps. DevOps is sharing the direction and sharing the goal and sailing the same boat to that goal. And there is huge amount of ways how to define DevOps. And I like that one, which is Calm's, which is one of the first ones, standing for the culture automation, lean monitoring and sharing. And if you open any article on how to do a DevOps, which is not like about Kubernetes or CI/CD pipelines, which is about transforming your organization or your team, they all start with like, you have to change the culture. You cannot go within a DevOps way of working without the changing the culture. And this is key here. And the question is, how? How we are going to change the culture in the first place? It's not like, okay, we are changing the culture from Monday. Here's the backlog of Agile tickets. You get it. It's not working like that. It will never work like that. We also encountered that issue. I was the one who was like running around and saying, we need to change the culture, going to the managers, going to the CTOs and everyone. And everyone saying, mean, why, how, what do you mean? So we decided, or not decided, it's naturally come to the truth that you are not changing the culture in the first place. The pattern that we developed, it's you are starting from automation, and then you put sharing into the mix, and then the cultural changes, they emerge. So let me give you an example. I really like that example from one of the projects. We have a very huge, complicated engineering system, which is very important for the world. And we're doing the transformation of that system, and the team was like using very archaic processes, and the application was very monolithic, and they were very siloed, like developers versus testers versus project management versus operations, etc. And when we start to be included in that team, and we started to help them with like automating everything. We start with the environment creation automation, then goes to the build automation, then goes to the pull request, pre-merge checks, then we did like nightly testing, performance testing, everything we automated. And the second very important thing here is that we show them the way how to share the processes. So everybody working in the same, it was Bitbucket, in the same Bitbucket, in the same Jira, sharing the same like commit messages and pull request processes and everything. So all of the team members, testers, automated testers, developers, operations, everyone were able to look at the, any other part of the code. And they then, for example, operations guy said, I opened the pull request. Everyone in the team understand what exactly that means and where to look at that pull request. So one bright day in that team, there was a tester who, like looking around, opened a list of opened pull requests to the application code, find the pull request which fixes a very important bug, click the button, deploys that pull request to his own environment, tested the bug, tested the everything around, goes to the developer and says, okay, your bug is fixed, but we have a regression here, here, and here, and they were managed to fix that even before the pull requests were merged in. And you could imagine that with the huge systems, getting into the build process, getting into the full regression cycle, which takes like a week, even automated, that is huge amount of time saved and a huge quality boost. And that's we started, at that point, we started to observe the emerging cultural changes. Those guys then go to each other and they automated even that thing. So nobody asked the tester to do so. Nobody even think that it is possible. But that just happened. And the cultural change happened across whole of the team. We just give them automation, just help them to do the work that they used to do. And when you have those free, at that time you start to monitor your process, how the project is going on, and the results of that monitoring led to more lean manufacturing line. So for example, in that particular scenario, people get used to testers go and check their pull requests, but it started to take a lot of time from the testing team, and that was noted, and that part was automated. The most of it. So that's how we do a cultural change. If you think that your company, there are dumps working in your company or in your team that don't want to change the culture, just help them work, just automate it. And this will naturally evolve. Okay, the next one that I have, and this is where we see a lot of feedback. Okay, you automate the things. That's great, but how on the earth you are going to automate that huge beast, right? And you probably, if you were in any of the agile trainings, you were presented with the video comparing two pit stops of the Formula One cars. And the one on the left is like pit stop from the 60s, which takes 1.5 minutes and was considered super fast by the people of the era. And on the right side, you have a modern pit stop, which barely takes 1 second. And the goal of such presentation is to show that in order to be agile, in order to move faster, your car needs to support it. Your underlying technology really needs to be on the level to move faster. And what I would say is yes, but you could always have a spare car, right? If your car is super slow to change the wheels, just have another one ready when the driver came into the pit stop. If it's not possible for you to build your builds faster, then pre-build them up front. Or another way of working, if change the wheels on your car is super slow, you could cut your car in 3 pieces and make sure you have a speed locks in those pieces and have a pre-built part of the car with the new wheels and just change it fast. It's a software, it's supposed to be soft, so you could do a lot of things. And on the technical part of the game, what we do and what is working for us. First of all, there is at least one super heavy hitter issue in the technological stack of your application. Like it's outdated hardware or probably middleware approaching the end of life. And just get rid of it. But leave everything as is. Get rid of a single piece. It's always a big amount of work. But everything rest, leave as is. Modularize as much as you can. put all of the modules into the containers and run them on Kubernetes. This is where I also hit a lot of drawbacks from the customers. What Kubernetes? We have a COBOL code, right? It's a huge monolithic application. So the thing is, running in Kubernetes means that you don't have to solve a lot of problems. If you are into the Kubernetes ecosystem, that you naturally have monitoring, logging aggregation, logging analytics, heuristics about your performance of your system, auto-scaling, request tracking, request retrying, and all that stuff, all those hard pieces that doesn't have anything to do with the business logic of your application, they are solved in the Kubernetes. And it's wise to just reuse it because everything rest is hard. Changing the most impacting technology layer within your application is hard. And make sure that you're making easy everything rest. So what else we have here? Oh, of course, there is the last bullet, which is very important. Don't be afraid to script things. For example, I had a system which does not support Git, does not support like API calls, API automation. It was just a web application without any API. And it was very important to have certain workflows automated. Just use Selenium and automate this. There is always a way to automate workflows. So don't be afraid to do that. Make sure that you're pre-building a lot of stuff and make sure that you're reusing the work of the industry standard projects. Okay. The next one is a natural the natural reaction to what I have presented before. So modernizing the current application is very hard. Even if you retain all of it, but just replace the single platform thing. So it is hard, and people are trying to skip that hard part. There are so many phases in this challenge, and I would like to focus on the last one. I have a customer who says, okay, we have a legacy, that legacy thing, which is so huge, 25 years of development. And we don't like that. We want to go to the cloud. We don't want to modernize as it is. We want to go to the cloud, and what we are going to do, we are going to slice and dice and move one piece of functionality out of legacy system, rewrite it in full, and deploy it to the cloud. So they just skipped all of that modernization, cultural, blah, blah, blah. We just put one function and put it into the cloud. And what they end up, so first of all, they, of course, totally underestimated the effort. And they spent 2 years already, and like 25% of the functionality being rewritten. And they are in the situation that for the legacy software, there is a huge amount of middleware software, which is end of life, end of this year. And they cannot get an insurance for their business, so they essentially cannot run the business on the outdated software. And right now, they are running a project to update the middleware from totally totally outdated version to a slightly less outdated version, to buy themselves another 2 years. So that's a huge waste of money if they did the modernization before and then started to rewrite things. That would be much easier and much cheaper. So that's the solution, and that's the pattern that we see. And this is where like DevOps way of working is very important. First thing what we do within the modernizing huge applications is we do architectural enablement. You just leave the functional body as it is and move your application into the platform that supports future improvement, that supports moving faster. And for us, Kubernetes is that platform, and we are not the only ones. So first step, get out of the most impacting piece of technology, land on the platform that supports the way of working, and very important, start to practice your CI/CD pipeline, start to practice your delivery, progressive delivery into production, start to practice pull requests. That's a huge effort for the teams that never did this. So it's much easier, much more natural for them to work in a new way with the software that they know. They know the software, they know the code base, they know how it works, and they just put automation and agility on top of it. So that's a very important step, and that's the only step that is a big bang. You cannot do that modernization in a like an iterative manner. So the next step is re-engineering. So, oh, by the way, architectural enablement is a step where 80% of the goals that CTOs has for the modernization are solved. So it's you don't have to do all the way. The most problems are being solved by that goal, by that step. So the next step is re-engineering, is where you start rewriting, rewinding, doing additional layers of integrations, maybe changing your data, whatever, right? It's much more easier in that step because your platform, your architecture supports that. You are not starting in a green field. You have your customer served, and you have like application up and running, and you could start iterate over business requirements, integrations, UI, UX, and everything like so. And the last step is a digital evolution. This is where it's hard to define for all of the companies, but usually it is what the sitting in the bottom of the backlog, like the high fantasy scenarios that people dream about. This is where you could start to put this from bottom to the top of the backlog, because your application, your platform is supporting that. You can do it right now. And the last one is a buy-in of the engineering team. Again, we see a lot of resistance from the teams. So how it works? You came in, you do a small POC, you show them, this is your pipelines, this is how your application is going to run on a new platform, this is all that fancy dashboards, and they don't like, they don't need it. They say, okay, we are working here for ages, we have seen people like you yelling around about fancy new stuff for several times already, and we were able to survive that, we don't need all this. Of course, the big part of that problem is job security, and another part of this problem is that they just don't understand why they need it. So, and the business people are usually put into the mix because, you know, when you change at least way of working and you have an army of developers or operations or users that needs to change, it's a huge training effort and all that stuff. So they just don't buy the idea of having a DevOps within the modernizing world. What we do here, so first of all, give them laptops. They used to work on the outdated hardware. Give them something fancy. And the second is, in the big organizations, with the big products, there is always a lack of environments. People are so used to ask, hey, can I run this database script? Oh, I would like to run, performance testing. Let's get together like 20 people into the Teams call and understand when we could run this 3-hour test. Okay, that's so normal for the big companies. And what we could do here is just give them environments as much as they need. We usually come to a point of environment per engineer. And this is super easy on the modern platform. Also, those environments are really need to be like fully integrated. They need to be production-like. All of the configuration files, all of the values needs to be like a production with maybe very small tweaks, because people are also very used to like this environment. I have this set of files, and I have that branch that goes to that environment, and those configuration parameters are named differently on different environments, and there is a mess. And when you start to say, okay, every environment going to be production-like with the same files, same everything, they are started to like it. If they can blow their environment on their own without asking anyone, that's the key for the engineering like success. So the next one here is, of course, there is always a challenge of autonomous work in the engineering. We give them way to work autonomously and not distract anyone and not being distracted. And of course, the feedback loops, the thing that everybody keeps talking about, those feedback loops need to be as short as possible. If your like pull request check is going to take like 2 hours, nobody really liked it. So make sure when we do some checks, they are failing fast. They are providing feedback as early as possible. So that's probably it. So the TLDR version of that presentation is here on the slide. I would like, as a follow-up from all of this, if you're trying to implement DevOps, don't ask people to change to implement DevOps. Help them. It's up to a person who is wanting to implement DevOps or to the team who trying to move DevOps to help people, to give them tools to have that DevOps emerging. And hope this helps you to do a DevOps modernization of your projects. That's all from me. Thank you very much. Any questions?
You said that we need as much environments as we want, but how to make a customer agree with this? Because, for example, my project, our customer decided that we need only one environment, it's dev. All the other environments, they are unavailable for us. They are present, we have QA regression and so on, but we can do nothing there because they are created for another teams. Mm-hmm. So how to make customer agree with this?
You don't have to. In that first example that I said, we hosted the environments for the developers of a customer, just by our own, to build them. And that took a year for the customer to understand that it's a good thing, and they, in the end, build a lab in their own data center. But while we do that, we hosted the environments for the developers of the customer, just giving them tools. That's it.
I've spent 6 months. Seems like soon they will understand it.
Nice. All right. So guys, if you have a like DevOps question in mind or transformation or migration question in mind, here's my email. I can help anyone with any whatever question you have. Just start with email. I do have different means of communication, but please start with email. It's easier for me to track those integrations, interactions. Okay? And I will hear if you have any other questions. Thanks.